and request not to start the video. So good afternoon, everyone. We'll start this first SCM talk show. So now actually we are planning to have this talk show every fortnight. And the topics basically that we have chosen is based on the survey that we sent to everyone. And I think a lot of responses came and we collated that, all those responses. And then we went about, you know, which topic is, you know, being most sought after. And based on that, we decided today's topic. So the session is going to be recorded and it's going to be made available, free on the NovX mobile app. As you know that we have a mobile app that is the name of NovX, and you can download that app. There are past free sessions also are available, and today's session also is going to be available. So I would request Gitesh to put everyone on a listen only mode. If you have questions during our chat show, please use the chat box to send the question. We will summarize those questions at the end, and depending on the availability of the time, you know, we will take the question for Dr. Sinha to respond. So to begin with, it's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Sinha. I think everyone knows, would know him, you know, very well. He does not require an introduction, but for the formality's sake, let me give you a brief introduction of Dr. Sinha. He worked with Godrej Consumer Products for almost four decades, with leading role in manufacturing, project, supply chain, strategy, IT, and marketing. His experience spans across several countries, of course, India being one, but US, Indonesia, Africa, Argentina, and Chile. He was the global head of supply chain, manufacturing, and IT before his superannuation. He holds the distinction of being the first doctorate in supply chain management in India. Now, Dr. Sinha has founded a specialized consulting firm called Reflexive Supply Chain Solutions that is focused on improving agility in supply chains. So he consults with FMCG companies, retailers, 3PL service providers, and supply chain startups also, in the area of operations and supply chain management. He also advises supply chain consulting firms as subject matter expert. So welcome, Dr. Sinha.
Thank you. Thank you, Ravi.
So I would like to thank Dr. Sinha for accepting our invitation to share, you know, the best practices that he has followed, you know, and to share with all the listeners the insight, you know, that he has gathered over several number of years. It's a privilege actually to have him here, and I think for all of us to listen to his, wisdom. So without actually, you know, spending a lot of time, I'll start the discussion on today's topic, inventory optimization. I think inventory optimization is probably the topmost objective of supply chain managers of all kinds of companies, irrespective of which country, which business, where you are. And probably that is why it came highest in the, number of topics that people sought after. So that is the highest. So as we know that inventory by itself is an indicator of supply chain management performance. Okay, so a lot of people say that, you know, lower the inventory, the performance supply chain is better. And, you know, we talk about performance from score perspective. We have five attributes like reliability, responsiveness, agility, cost, and asset utilization. I think all are impacted by inventory optimization. So if we must broadly state the purpose of inventory, I think it is decoupling. I'm not trying to take an educational class for, you know, inventory, but basically it's decoupling. So decoupling of timing, location, flow rates, batch sizes, transportation, et cetera, et cetera. And as you know that if everything is coupled, opposite of decoupling, or what we can call is create a flow from, let's say, one end of supply chain to other end, that is from Mother Nature till the consumer, okay, that that inventory is going to be more optimized. And the term, when we say optimization, it means that inventory is neither too little nor too much, just the right amount of inventory. However, we all know that most companies suffer from both ends, shortages on one hand and excess stocks on other hand. At the same time, every day we have that list. So let us hear from Dr. Sinha, who applied very innovative methodologies for planning, scheduling, and execution for inventory optimization in Godrej Consumer Products. So, Dr. Sinha, my first question to you, inventory optimization obviously begins from planning. And one of the major inputs to planning is demand plan. Can you please share your thoughts on what kind of planning, including demand planning, is relevant in today's volatile demand scenario, or some people call it VUCA world, both during black swan events like COVID pandemic, and even during normal, you know, times, you know, I want you to throw light on demand-driven system versus forecast-driven system, and also want to share your experience about planning bucket sizes, review frequencies, and so on. Dr. Sinha, to you.
Yeah. So a lot of questions in one. Let's start with how do we run the supply chain? For running the supply chain, there are two types of broadly actions. One, which is more related to the design of the supply chain, and these actions are medium term to long term actions. Things like how much capacity should we have, where should we have, where should the nodes for distribution be. These are really medium term to long term actions. The second set of actions is the execution on a daily basis. Now, if we look at the conventional demand plan, which comes out of S&OP or IBP processes, this is good for medium to long term supply chain actions. But it's not so good. I would say that at times it's terrible for short term supply actions. So for short term supply actions, what we need is not the demand plan, which we have agreed in the S&OP, but rather day to day tracking and sensing of how the market is behaving. Because you actually commit to inventory the moment we manufacture something. We commit to the finished goods inventory. Let's talk about finished goods first. The moment we manufacture something, we commit to the inventory. And if what we manufacture is not in line with what's being bought by the consumers, then we will have a bimodal distribution of inventory, excess somewhere and shortage somewhere else, because what we have made is not in line with the market requirement. So the first part of planning is how do you link your entire manufacturing to the what is moving in the market on a dynamic basis. And this linkage is not synchronized on a monthly or a weekly basis. It has to be done on a daily basis. So there are three parts of it, if I can take a couple of minutes.
Sure.
Parts of it. The first part in synchronization is how well are we tuned into the consumer demand. And by tuning, I mean, are we listening to, are we observing what the consumer is buying on a day-to-day basis? How close to the consumer are we observing? Is it at the retail level? Is it at distributor level? Is it at CFA level? Where do we record the consumption that is going out of the out to the consumer? The closer we are to the consumer, the more pristine the demand sensing will be. The farther away we are, it will get colored. And we won't be fine-tuned. It's like if you are tuning into FM, say 104.0. If you are at 103.9 or so, you can hear the song, but there's a lot of noise around it.
Yes,
the closer true. You are, if you are at 104.0, the signal will be pristine signal. So the closer we are to the consumer, the pristine demand signal we would get. So that's very important. And for day-to-day supply chain actions, we don't really need an estimate of how the consumer will buy over a longer term. What we need is a fairly good idea of how the demand is expected over the next 2 days, 3 days, 5 days, 7 days, rarely for more than 15 days. That's all that is required for running the supply chain. So the 3 month forecast, 6 month forecast have no meaning for running day-to-day supply chain. So once we have a good sense of demand sensing, then there are a couple of more capabilities which the organizations should develop for inventory optimization. One is, of course, the how well do we respond to this demand signal. So if the demand has gone up in a particular geography, and we are talking of demand sensing at the most granular level on a daily basis, possibly at SKU store level, or if that's not available, then SKU distributor level definitely. So about 2,000 distributors in the country for a typical FMCG company, and say 500 SKUs. So we need to capture these 500 into 200 movement every day and then run the entire supply chain on that basis. So how quickly do we respond? For example, if we find that the demand for, say, Goodnight in Surat, how soon can we respond? Because if you're collecting this data on daily basis, the response should be within 24 hours. And by response, it can't be, we can't take a week to decide how to respond to this. So how well are we responding? How soon are we responding? And the entire supply chain, entire value chain has to respond. Not only the distribution, the CFA and distributors, but manufacturing has to respond in terms of higher production. Vendors have to respond in terms of higher input materials delivery. So how soon can the entire supply chain respond? If it's taking more than 24 hours, then we are not agile enough. And the third part, obviously, is for running this type of agile system, you need a tremendous amount of flexibility in all legs, whether it's manufacturing and distribution, it's procurement. So this flexibility, responsiveness, coupled with an accurate demand sensing are the three pillars. And when we talk of inventory optimization, actually, we are talking of improving the capabilities on all these three pillars. Because unless we improve the fundamental capabilities, it's imprudent to expect inventory reduction without adverse impact on customer service. So if you want to maintain customer service at 95, 99, whatever percent we are currently, and reduce inventory, then we have to touch one of these three: improve the demand sensing, improve the responsiveness, and improve flexibility. If you're not doing any of these things, it becomes just a wish list that the inventory should go down. It won't.
Thank you, Dr. Sinha. So I think what you said is that for medium term and long term planning, we can use forecast driven, but for operation level planning, you know, we need to have a demand driven type of a system where, you know, we react on a daily basis. So sort of a daily planning bucket sort of a thing. Correct. Now, this question comes up obviously with anybody's mind and a lot of planners' mind that, you know, how do we handle long lead time items? Because most companies use imported raw materials and the lead times there are about 1 month, ranging from 1 month to 3 months. So there are a lot of lead times involved and, you know, large batch size, you know, containers full of material has to be imported. And add to that, you know, production lead times and distribution lead times and delivery lead times. So there is a, you know, the lead times become quite long and the customer usually expect a small delivery lead time, you know, very, very short delivery lead time. Customer may obviously take months and months to finalize the order, but once they give you the order, then they want the delivery yesterday. So, you know, so due to this issue, many supply chain professionals feel that demand-driven system will not work. This is not going to work. So many also think that demand-driven system or pull system that we follow in Lean also are suitable only for uniform demand products that are highly forecastable, where demand is lumpy and demand-driven systems may not work. So what is the insight that you can give to our listeners?
Actually, for a stable demand, you don't need any plans. If you're selling 100 units a day, you don't need any sort of planning. Anybody can plan how what to manufacture and what to procure. You need planning because you don't have a uniform demand. And the more volatile the demand is, the demand-driven supply chains work better. In fact, they're better suited for highly volatile items. Now, there are a couple of things. One is we are talking of cumulative lead time of procurement, manufacturing, and distribution. Actually, if you implement it correctly and pass the demand signal all the way from the retail point up to the vendor's point on a daily basis, what you are facing is actually not a cumulative lead time, but individual lead time. I'll just give you an example. Suppose for our soaps, we procure wrappers. Okay, a wrapper for our soaps. So suppose a vendor is giving us a wrapper, and based on the soaps that we sell, we consume on an average, say, 50 kg wrapper of that particular SKU per day. And his lot size is for delivery is 1 ton. So roughly every 20 days, he would deliver 1 ton of wrapper. I'm taking very simple case. Now, if you place an order after 20 days and say, I need 1 ton of wrapper, he may take another 10 days to manufacture and 5 days to ship. So you are adding that 15 days lead time. Now, in a demand-driven supply chain, what happens is every day you know what amount of wrapper which is embedded in the finished goods has been sold. So you know the finished goods sales, so you know what amount of wrapper has been consumed out of the system, has gone to the consumers in, suppose that is for 50 kg. So you pass this 50 kg of virtual order to the vendor. That 50 kg worth of wrappers in the finished goods inventory has gone out of finished goods. So he knows that when this cumulative one is touching 1 ton, he needs to dispatch 1 ton. So he has a fairly good idea. Suppose one day you consume 200 kg worth of wrappers because the demand has been very good on that day. So the moment it comes to 700, 800 kg, he can take a run, knowing fully well that in the next 2-3 days, he will get the order for 1 ton. So how transparently you are transmitting this signal from the demand up to the vendors is what matters. Then the lead time become just 2 days for him. It's not 15 days. So there are systems to pass on this demand, and we have the concept of order daily, replenish frequently. That's a very, very important concept. So the orders would go daily, but when the order size becomes a lot size equivalent, the vendor would deliver. So, but it's important not to hold back the order. Keep releasing the order and then ask for replenishment when the lot size is there. So we can cut the lead time in several ways. Of course, for some of the imported items, because of the freight part, if the lead time is actually, the freight time itself is 20 to 30 days, then we have no option but to go back to the monthly forecast that we have and order on that basis. But the safety stock there will be more because we are taking care of the demand variation in the meantime. But wherever it's possible, we can cut down the lead time and we can thereby cut down the overall response time.
Thank you, Dr. Sinha. So I'll ask one more question about, a lot of people are saying RIP forecast, so forecasting is dead. So do you think forecasting is dead? So what about a lot of forecasting tools, new forecasting tools like demand sensing tools that use AI, ML, software vendors are claiming the demand forecast can be highly accurate than never before. So as a practitioner and as you also head an information technology function, what vision would you be like to share to Vishnu about these tools and or techniques and applicability of them to be able to forecast more accurately?
So actually, I was the one who started this, that the demand forecasting is dead, but it's a bit misquoted, I must say. What I said was the conventional demand forecasting applied to all sorts of supply chain actions, that part is dead. Each forecast has a relevant range. So the forecast that we do on a monthly basis, that range is 3 months to 12 months for actions. But for daily actions, we need a different type of forecast, which is much more granular at SKU store level or SKU distributor level. It's generated every day and it's generated even for tomorrow. So it's not that the forecasting is done 2 months in advance. This has to be done on a daily basis for tomorrow and a few days later. So when I say forecasting is dead, it's really like a phoenix. It's reborn, but reborn with two heads. So the conventional forecasting continues and there are better and better forecasting models to take care of the accuracy of forecast over the 3 months and 6 months period. That's one part. But for supply actions, we need what I call as agile forecasting, which is at the most granular level done on a daily basis and without a human touch. So the AI ML techniques are very handy, which can pick up the trend much faster than humans can. So these can pick up the trends at the most granular level, knowing that, for example, there are certain products which are seasonal. So we know that when the winter sets in, the demand for the winter products would go up. But we can't forecast when the winter would set in each and every town. It may set in on a certain date in Delhi, different date in Ludhiana and Jalandhar, etc. But these demand sensing tools, which capture the consumption on a daily basis at the most granular level, can find out when the consumption pattern indicates that the winter has set in, and also take help of possibly the weather data if required. Very rarely it's required, because the demand itself shows us that the winter has set in this part of the country, and accordingly step up the expected demand over the next 2 days, 5 days, 10 days, etc. So these are very helpful for supply chain action. So forecasting is reborn in two different forms. It's not a single forecast. It's a forecast for long-term supply chain actions and a forecast for daily supply chain execution. And both these forecasts are have quite different methodology and different uses. So we should respect both the forecast and these can peacefully coexist.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
So I think moving ahead from planning to detailed scheduling, especially of intermediates, raw materials, components, what methodology you suggest organization can adopt for inventory optimization? How can they be sure that inventory is neither, there are no shortages, at the same time, no excesses?
Correct. So the demand signal would reach the factories within 24 hours in terms of what needs to be manufactured. After that, it depends on the flexibility that we have on the manufacturing lines. If the manufacturing lines are rigid, they take long batch sizes at a time, then obviously we will need to cover it up with higher finished goods inventory at the factory. So the more flexibility we bring into the manufacturing line, every time we improve the flexibility, this excess inventory that we are carrying at the plant warehouse would keep going down. Because if you are able to manufacture all the SKUs every day, then you don't need to keep more than a day's inventory at the plant warehouse. So inventory is actually, it's a reflection of how rigid our systems are. Because the systems are flexible, then the inventory will go down. And actually, I'll just give you a simile. Imagine that if the finished goods could move at the speed of light. So when the consumer needs something, the factory can deliver within a few minutes or a few seconds or a few hours. That's utopian. But just for explaining, it's important that if finished goods could move at the speed of light, you don't need to carry finished goods inventory. You manufacture and you get it to the consumer, which is really the case in case of power generating companies. Because electricity moves at the speed of light. So when I switch on a fan, I consume extra electricity, and extra electricity gets generated at the power plant and it comes to my house. There is no inventory of electricity in the system. So if we can improve the flow of products. The faster the products flow from manufacturing unit to the consumer, the lower the inventory would be. Just to give you an idea of what type of inventory reduction is possible, most of the FMCG companies in India, if you see the weighted average distance covered by their finished goods to the consumption points, various consumption points all over the country, it will be anywhere between 500 to 1,000 kilometers, not more than that. So weighted average distance could be anywhere 500 to 1,000 kilometers. And nowadays, trucks can cover up to 600, 700 kilometers a day. So ideally, 2 days of inventory is what we should have of finished goods if we have full flexibility. If you are able to manufacture everything every single day, if the demand sensing is pristine and accurate. So if we are carrying more than 2 days inventory, that means there is some inaccuracy in demand sensing for which we need to buffer. There is some inaccuracy in terms of our distribution function, some inflexibility in our distribution function. So we need to keep inventory at several places. The transit times are not as fast as they could be. The manufacturing is not flexible. The vendors are not flexible. So our endeavor should be to keep improving the flexibility and then expect the inventory to come down. Doing the other way around just doesn't work. That you bring down the inventory, you would have shortages. Unless inherently your your system becomes more flexible.
Great, wonderful. So thank you. Very exciting insight. Now I have one more question about, detail scheduling. There are some methodologies like TOC, and you have some lean, which advocates very uniform scheduling, especially in the environment where, large production batches and large packaging sizes and transportation batch, batches are, used. So how do you think how this can be used? In fact,
so the moment we talk of large batches, we are talking of again inflexibility.
Yeah.
So everywhere, if there is inflexibility, you would need some sort of a compromise. And uniform production every day is actually a compromise, because we are not flexible enough to produce 100 tons in one day, 70 tons the next day, and 200 tons the third day. We don't have that flexibility. The moment we develop that flexibility, we don't really need a uniform production every day. It's a compromise because we don't have flexibility. So our endeavor should be to keep increasing this flexibility. And of course, it would also be that some days you need to produce 200 tons. So you need to have capacity for 200 tons production in a day. By smoothening the production, you can bring down the overall capacity requirement. But there are hundreds of ways to improve the capacity at zero cost. And TOC has many of these methodologies. So what is broadly known as debottlenecking of capacities at no extra capex. So once you debottleneck the capacity, if a plant was supposed to produce 100 tons a day, you can easily debottleneck it to 150, 160, 200 tons a day by following some of the TOC practices. So once you bring that flexibility and generate extra capacity, then you don't need level production. So in my opinion, level production is a compromise because of inflexibility in our production system. Lean as such, whether you produce 70 tons or 200 tons, lean is very useful because the product should keep moving instead of stopping at certain workstations. So flow is important. So that part of lean is extremely good. We should use it, but not necessary to level the production every day.
All right. Okay. So I have one more question that, many organizations give a lot of emphasis on cost. I mean, I know all the costing methodologies are obsolete. They were created in an era where, the automation was very, very less. The more manual effort, and therefore, the way they distribute overheads was different. But I think when we go to organizations and talk about reducing the batch sizes, immediately there is a concern about, the cost, part of it. Now, the recent techniques, DDMRP, claimed that, if you can create a flow, you can maximize ROI and you don't need to focus on cost. And I think the same thought was there with TOC and lean also. Instead of focusing on cost, let's focus on throughput and let's focus on ROI. So what are your thoughts on this?
In fact, even costing has this methodology. I studied costing way back in early 80s, 35, 40 years back. And the concept of variable costing, the concept of marginal costing, has always been there, but companies have not been using it. So if you are on variable costing basis, then the cost of setup has no meaning. So you do your product costing on a variable basis. Yeah. Setup is important. It's important to reduce the setup to improve the flexibility, not to bring down the cost. Yeah. And the more flexible you are, the lower the inventory you would carry. So using the techniques like SMED, you could improve the flexibility of the plant. It won't bring down the cost, but it will give you enough flexibility to run your operations smoothly without carrying too much of it. So marginal costing, throughput accounting in TOC, throughput accounting in DDMRP, all are same. That you look at the variable cost, and in certain cases, if you are touching the edge of the full capacity utilization and it means you need to incur extra expenditure in creating more capacity, then go to marginal costing instead of just variable costing. So the concept of, if you apply judicially, the variable costing concept, marginal costing concept, which is same as throughput accounting in TOC, then you are through. Just the total cost concept is what vitiates the whole picture. So we should not use just the total cost where you distribute the overheads to the to all the products.
Right.
You should keep overhead separately. Work out what is known as the contribution, which is your sales price minus the variable cost, and compare the total contribution that you generate versus the total overheads as one lump. Total overheads should be seen as one lump and not distributed to the products.
Thank
so
you.
Basically, the same methodology. I don't think there is anything new. The numbers, the terms are new, and the only improvement is move away from total cost accounting.
Thank you. And so before I start the next segment, you know, do you have any thoughts on any additional thoughts on inventory optimization, or would you like to summarize?
Yeah, so inventory is a reflection of how far we are from being agile. So the farther we are inventory, we need to if you see even beings, the most agile human beings like the martial artists like Bruce Lee, etc.
Inventory optimization.
And there's some background noise. Can you please put your mic on mute? I'll appreciate that. Thank you. Yes.
Yeah. So inventory is a reflection of how far we are from being agile. So even if you take the simile, we have body fat because that's the buffer for our nutritional requirements in case we don't get food. So body stores fat, which is like the inventory buffer. So the more agile you are, the less fat you would have. And if you look at people like Bruce Lee, the most agile people, they have hardly any excess body fat. So likewise, the more agile our system becomes, the inventory should keep coming down. And that's the way to reduce inventory, not just cutting some notes here and there. But unless you make the organization more agile, you can't hope for lower inventory. So my submission would be that keep working on the agility concepts. And inventory is just an offshoot of that. Cost is also an offshoot. You will see the cost coming down, you'll see inventory coming down, you'll see the service levels going up. Everything would improve if you move the organization on the agility journey.
Thanks, Dr. Sinha. So let me go to the next segment of our talk show. So let me ask you, how did you land up in supply chain management starting from your childhood? This was by accident or by your choice? So if it was by your choice, then why did you select supply chain management as your career?
Actually, when I joined Godrej, I handled production, maintenance projects for about 8 to 10 years, and coupled with strategic planning after that. So I entered supply chain after that because I happened to move into a position which required handling of logistics, handling of the company's supply planning, etc. The moment I started handling it, I found it extremely extremely challenging and extremely rewarding. Of course, when I was studying at NITI, I was exposed to the concept of MRP, which really struck me as a very useful technique. So right since then, planning has been in my mind. And when I got a chance to get into planning and execution of the supply chain, I could apply all the concepts. By that time, after some time, we read about the books of Dr. Goldratt, and that also helped a lot in crystallizing the thoughts. So ever since then, I enrolled for a PhD in IIT Bombay in supply chain management, and then the journey continued after that.
So, you know, in supply chain management, if I may ask you, what was your aha moments, you know, in your career that you felt really proud about supply chain management? If you can recollect right now and share some of the moments, if you recollect.
Yeah. So after reading about replenishment and TOC of Dr. Goldratt, we tried implementing replenishment on our own in the last leg, that is between our CFAs and distributors. This was way back in 98, way back. So 22 years back, we implemented that and we applied all the concepts in the most pristine way. So So, for example, doing the distributor orders on a no-touch basis. So we moved away from distributors placing order to auto generation of orders based on the inventory norms which we set at the distributor level. We track the consumption every day, what they are selling to the retailers, and dynamically adjusted inventory norms based on the acceleration or deceleration of product flow. And then based on the inventory norm and actual orders, the distributor orders were self-generated without any human touch. So this worked very well. So that was really an aha moment when very few companies, I don't recall any other FMCG company in the country doing that replenishment part. So we got a head start really. And in 2004, when we tied up with Goldratt Consulting and worked with Dr. Eli Goldratt himself to take it from the last leg of distribution to the previous legs, establishing regional distribution centers, a plant warehouse, doing a dynamic production scheduling and vendor ordering, all that. We extended this replenishment right up to the vendors. So that was another aha moment, lot of learning. And we are the first FMCG company to do that. And for the last 16 years, we have been running on that system. And our fill rates, our customer service levels have always been the highest in the country. Last 5 years, we are running ahead of 99% service levels consecutively. So that was another aha moment, working with Dr. Goldratt himself. When our efforts were recognized in 2015, there is a body called TOC-ICO, which is a worldwide body, TOC International Certification Organization. So they give awards from time to time. So at their annual conference in 2015, they gave an award to GCPL for innovative TOC practices and consistently delivering results for more than 10 years consecutively. So they gave a platinum level award to GCPL. That was an aha moment because not only we were the first one in the country to get platinum, we were the first one in the world to get platinum in FMCG.
Oh, wow.
Only company in FMCG in the entire world which got a platinum award. So that was a big, big, big aha moment for all of us, for the whole team which was working on this. So, and then there have been several smaller aha moments, like when we implemented it in each of the countries in Africa. The entire replenishment, entire TOC, basically the DDMRP concepts, when we implemented and got the benefits. So that proved that it can be applied anywhere. Africa is relatively less data centric. We don't have the basic systems, but still TOC worked very well. And our last application has been in US, which is the most advanced country. And there also we came to almost 100% fill rate with Walmart in US. So there are a lot of aha moments and confirming that yes, it works across all the environments, across all the geographies, across all the different businesses that we could do.
So I think you have had a lot of experience, you know, every area, even in education. So I would like to ask you a question for the benefit of all the listeners about, you know, the formal education versus certification. So what is your advice? What are the useful academic oriented education versus practice oriented certifications? What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah.
Is it really required?
Education helps. And I have myself continued education for about 15, 20 years very actively after joining Godrej. So education definitely helps because you get exposed to different types of models that opens up your thinking. But there is no substitute for actual practice.
Yeah.
So going to the Gemba, applying it yourself, making the mistakes, learning from it, there's no substitute for that. So just theoretical education doesn't help. It's necessary, but not sufficient.
Absolutely.
it's necessary. You must go through it. You get exposed to as many different types of models as possible. See where this could be used. And when you go to the Gemba, to a factory or to a particular company and start applying it, if you are exposed to more number of models, you would know which model would work better here, and exposed to all the principles behind that model. So you can apply it in your own way, rather than a copybook style application. But each context is different. If you know the basics, if you know the reasoning behind the model, then I would suggest that you apply it in your own way, apply it in a commonsensical way, what really appeals to your heart, rather than a bookish application. So both are important. Certification is important, but practice is
more important. So what is your advice to our listeners to accelerate their career growth in supply chain management field? What future do you see for supply chain profession? So one question everyone has in mind is, can a supply chain manager reach the level of CEO or MD, and what is the probability, and which type of industry there is a probability of growth of supply chain professional?
The head of Apple was a supply chain person. So Amazon person is basically a supply chain person. So a lot of people have reached. There is no fixed formula that a person at the top has to be from a particular discipline. Anybody can reach the top. So I don't think any particular profession gives you a head start. It depends on how well you care for the business and how do you take the business forward. Whether it's an HR person, finance person, marketing, sales, supply chain, doesn't matter. Anyone can reach the top. But if you really like the subject, then get into it, not because it's a fad to get into a supply chain management role. But if you really like the subject, and if you like applying it to day-to-day context, even outside the office context, even in the personal lives, you can apply a lot of TOC principles in the personal life. SMED works so well in the personal life. If you start observing people, we used to observe when people come to the office, and we had a card swiping system. There would be some people who would have a card in their hand so that they can swipe immediately. Some people would reach the card swiping machine, then keep looking inside their pockets as to where the I card is. So that's the concept of SMED. Do you keep things ready? So a lot of useful concepts that you study, you can actually find day-to-day uses. When you come home, do you have the key to your house in your hand when you reach the door? So a lot of these are actually useful in day-to-day concepts. All the theoretical concepts have a parallel use in our day-to-day life. And the more we use in day-to-day life, the better we will be in applying it to the industry. That's when it gets really internalized. When you apply
so much, Dr. Sinha, thank you so much. So it was really a great insight into, you have great insight and very, very useful. It's coming from horse's mouth, a practitioner's mouth. So I'm sure that, listeners have some question, and they must have posted those questions into our chat box. So I will hand over to Gitesh, who must have summarized those questions to ask, one by one, depending on, most asked questions first. Hitesh.
Okay. Hello, am I audible?
Yes. Yeah. Go ahead.
Hi, good afternoon all. So thank you, Dr. Sinha and Ravi sir, for such a wonderful session. We have a lot of questions from our listeners today. And to start with, I'll start with Mr. Hemant Kumar Singh. So his question is, can you please highlight on average daily demand calculation, what should be granularity in terms of days?
Yeah. So you need average daily demand. That still is becoming now an old concept. Average daily usage, ADU as it is called in DDMRP. That's what you fall back to if you don't have a good demand sensing system for the forward-looking demand. So if you don't have forward-looking demand, you go back to the ADU into a certain number of days. So what you really need is the pattern of the past consumption, In FMCG, for example, in India, when we looked at the consumption pattern of various FMCG, we saw a clear monthly cycle of purchase by the consumers. And this is not from companies' data, this is from IMRV's household data, which tracks the household purchases by sampling the households. So from the really the households data, we saw that is clearly a monthly cycle, and possibly because people here get paid on a monthly basis. So when they get paid, they tend to purchase a lot of items together. In other countries, for example, some of the European countries, we saw a clear weekly cycle, where the wages are paid on a weekly basis, even salaries in certain cases are paid on a week. So it depends a lot on the payment cycle of the consumers. So if you have a weekly cycle, then you should take at least average over a week. If you have a monthly cycle, you should take average over 30 days. So it depends on what is the inherent purchase cycle of the consumers for the goods that you are calculating ADU for. Yeah, does that answer your question?
Thank you, Dr. Sinha. I think we have answered that question to Mr. Hemant Kumar Singh. I'll take up the next question. That is from Mithali. So Mithali asks, to what level is manual intervention critical in inventory optimization? That is the first question. And her second question is there any benchmark for FMCG companies signifying this percentage, or adhering to only MRP and NRP or any system significant for inventory optimization?
In terms of manual intervention, you don't need manual intervention. You need intervention only in exceptional cases. So you need a system which identifies exceptions. And exceptions are two types. One is if the demand surge is more than what you are capable of serving. So every company is not infinitely flexible. So there are certain limits within which you can service the demand. If the demand has gone up more than that, for example, if there is a dengue outbreak in a particular city, say Baroda has a dengue outbreak, and the demand for some of our insecticide products goes up, say, 50 times, can you supply 50 times? If not, then it should throw up an exception, that our normal TOC-based replenishment system is unable to meet some of the increased demand. We had a case in Noida where during H1N1, where one fine morning in a particular school, I think Delhi Public School in Noida, there was an announcement that tomorrow all the students in the school should bring a hand sanitizer with them. And overnight, all the stocks of hand sanitizers in all the retail outlets, they vanish. So can you replenish that stock? How fast can you replenish? Can you do it in a day's time, or will you take 2-3? So this should come out as an exception. If your system can normally handle, say, 5x demand or 10x demand or 20x demand at a granular level, it should not come as an exception. But if it goes beyond your capability, it should come as an exception. And manual intervention will be required only if there are exceptions. For example, on certain routes, if there is a flood and the road is completely blocked, so truck is unlikely to reach in time, that should come out as an exception. Or if there is a curfew or Madras or Chennai gets locked down suddenly, that should come out as an exception, that you are likely to miss out on certain orders. Otherwise, manual intervention is not required for inventory optimization. Manual intervention is required for improving the capabilities of the company. Improving flexibility, obviously you need manual intervention. Improving responsiveness, obviously you need that. Improving demand sensing, yes, you need to fine-tune the models, etc. So those are the places which are the drivers of inventory. You should intervene very actively to keep improving those drivers, but not for day-to-day execution. It should be an autopilot mode.
Thank you, Dr. Sinha. That was really well said. So I hope that answers Mithali's question well elaborated. I'll take up the next question from Mr. Gaurav Bhatia, and he asks, philosophy of operational efficiency says take campaign also to avoid changeovers, whereas philosophy of lean says single piece flow. How do you follow or balance between the both?
You should be focused on the consumer. Are your consumers buying 10 tons of material at a time, or are they buying one piece at a time? And if you're talking of synchronizing supply with demand on a dynamic basis, your daily production should match more or less the daily consumption, which the consumers are buying. So it's just the principle of managing, synchronizing the input and the output, what you are putting into the system as fresh inventory and what is going out of the system as consumption by the consumers. The more close you are in matching this, the better your system would behave. So large batch sizes typically push a lot of inventory at a time, which is counterproductive. So on any day, if the consumer is buying in single pieces and all consumers put together are buying a certain amount of material, your production should match that. So I won't agree to taking large batch sizes because it gives you a slightly lower cost as measured on total cost basis. But if you look at the additional cost of carrying inventory, the obsolescence, and the stale products which reach the consumers, and you have to sell it either at a discount or write off certain products. If you add up all the cost, then it's definitely much more costly to produce in large batches compared to producing in small batches.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Sinha. So one question I look up here is with regards to the current scenario that is asked by Mr. Dharmendra. He says a report by Nielsen showed almost 86% of industry capturing FMCG and retail sector anticipates the supply chain and mobility hurdles to continue in the next 6 months. How can we minimize this hurdle specifically for retail sector?
The hurdles are external to what we can do. I don't know whether we can have influence over the external factors. All we can influence is our response to these external hurdles. If what you are referring to are external hurdles, if they are internal hurdles which are constraining you to fulfill the demand, by all means we should demolish those internal hurdles. If certain policies are coming in the way, if certain practices of the company are coming in the way, by all means we should get rid of those internal hurdles. But if they are external hurdles, we should learn how to run a hurdle race rather than trying to run a sprint of 100 meters. So there are different techniques for running a hurdle race and different techniques for running a sprint. We need to master both, and we need to navigate through the hurdles rather than hoping that either the hurdles will go away or we resign to the hurdles. No, we need to navigate through them and still manage to reach the consumer in time. There's no hurdle insurmountable.
Right. So, sir, we have very short time left now. So I'll just take one more question. We have multiple questions more, but unfortunately we'll be running out of time as well. So the question is from Mr. Yatrik Shah. He says, how to mitigate the back orders and stock out for low moving inventory?
See, stockouts have nothing to do whether it's a fast moving or slow moving. The same principle, the same practices, the same processes are applicable to fast moving as well as slow moving. TOC doesn't differentiate between the two. There may be more internal inefficiencies in slow moving items in terms of larger batch sizes because of the internal inflexibility that we have. Nevertheless, a stock out of even a slow moving item could be as disastrous as a stock out of a fast moving item, because if you continue to ignore the slow moving items, it will never have a chance to become a fast moving item in future. So you should give as much importance to slow moving item. I don't like this concept of ABC classification.
Right.
Because someday C class can become A class. For many companies, including Godrej, hand sanitizer was a C class item. Now it has become a super A class item. But if you had ignored C class and continued stock out and restricted distribution, never found a way to become A class. So we should apply the same principles, and it's not cumbersome because these practices, these processes are on autopilot mode. Only thing is, if you are taking very large batches of slow moving items, you should consciously work on cutting them down so that you don't push too much inventory which had to be written off.
Hitesh, you can take a couple of more questions, I think.
Right, sir. Thank you very much. I was about to ask that. So we have a question from Mr. Abhijit Raut. He says, is DDMRP efficient in case of made to order items compared with made to stock?
Both are two different types of systems, made to stock. DDMRP is useful in both. TOC is useful in both. For made to order, if there are many common items, then you can decouple those component items from the finished goods and manage their inventory separately. In either case, because of delinking of various parts of the supply chain, you get a faster response even in made to order. And most of the companies would have some items which are common. So it's good to put that as a decoupling point and then leave the variability only in the final leg of the order and thereby crash the lead time. You've seen lead times being crashed by as much as 50% to 80% in many cases by properly setting the decoupling points and maintaining the inventory there. But what you need only is the last mile conversion from the sub-assemblies or from the components to the final order. Even in cases like aircraft manufacture, which is typically a made to order, or shipbuilding, there are a lot of components and sub-assemblies which are kept in stock. They are managed more like made to stock rather than made to order. Although the final order is very unique for each customer. So you can't keep the final ship ready, but you can keep all the components, a lot of components ready, and finally convert it into the final ship in a few weeks' time and deliver, if you apply DDMRP properly and set the decoupling points.
Right. So that answers the question. I'll take up the next question from Mr. Ram. He says, how to avoid obsolescence in spare parts management?
Spare parts, there will be some amount of obsolescence. And as you keep improving and implement more of TPM in your factory, your machines won't break down as much. So it's possible that you have a spare part which has not been used for 5 years or 10 years. So some amount of obsolescence is inbuilt, and some amount of obsolescence is actually a good sign that your machine doesn't require so much of spare part. So we shouldn't frown upon obsolescence. We should really feel happy unless we are carrying too many parts of these. If we are carrying a single spare part, a particular spare part, and if that's not getting used, if it hasn't been used, it's a better state to be than if the spare part is used every now and then. So spare parts, yes, we have to live with some amount of obsolescence. Mostly the spare parts don't get obsolete unless you change the machine. The spare part can be used even after 5 years, 10 years, so long as, even in case of turbines, for example, if you bought a turbine 20 years back and a spare part has not been used, it's still in usable condition. Unless you go for an upgradation of the turbine, go for a different mechanism which makes certain spare parts obsolete. Otherwise, spare parts typically don't get obsolete.
So I'll start with a question from Mr. Sandeep Kumar. Yes. He says that how to do inventory reduction when manufacturing lead time is more than 3 months and raw material lead time is more as we procure raw material from other country. Yeah. So we have challenges to improve the flexibility and reduce the inventory. So how do we overcome that?
So my first comment is if the manufacturing lead time is 3 months, we should better work on reducing the manufacturing lead time. Should find out what's the actual touch time when some machine or the other or some human being or the other is working on the product directly. In my opinion, the active time would be much lower than 3 months, and the techniques of lean, where you streamline the flow, you cut out the non-value adding activities like waiting for a machine to operate, transporting material between two machines, between two operations, etc. These have to be, the waiting time and the holding time and the transport time have to be reduced. So I would recommend that you first apply lean. And I have seen that in some cases, when the lead time was similar, almost 2 to 3 months, after applying lean, it has been cut down to 2 to 3 weeks, and in some cases even 3 days. So first, it's important to cut down the lead time by applying lean, and then once the lead time is lower, all the replenishment can be done easily. Otherwise, you won't get the full benefits of replenishment. You'll end up with higher inventory and still miss out on some of the orders. So after applying lean, then you can go ahead with the inventory reduction.
So I think that other question about, you know, large import lead time, you already answered the question earlier, because, yeah, you know, the import lead times are longer and the batch size is more.
And typically, right, the raw materials are common across several SKUs. So there the planning can be done at an aggregate level. So even if we have to resort to the monthly forecast of S&OP for very long lead time raw materials, like in case of soaps, we make soap from palm oil derivatives. And the same palm oil derivatives go into all the SKUs of soaps. So there the planning is relatively easier. And the conversion to any specific soap is done at the last moment. So even if we hold inventory, there is no question of it getting obsolete. So raw materials won't get obsolete if these are common across several SKUs and not unique to a particular SKU. So going by the S&OP forecast is okay. Replenishment will keep giving signals or triggers that raw material is likely to run out in extreme cases. So it will give expediting signal, or in some cases it will give delaying signal. So if you can act on those signals in terms of either expediting the next consignment or delaying, then replenishment would still be useful. You know, the second point is many companies who import raw materials, including Godrej, we do store some inventory at the port, at the Kandla port. We import mostly through Kandla. So we store some inventory. So that acts as a buffer for a day-to-day replenishment to the factory. So by taking these 2-3 measures, I think raw materials can be managed. They are relatively easier to manage than finished goods.
Thank you, sir, for that answer. Just to add on to that question, sir, any mode of transportation would you prefer to transport it from port to factory when you have excess buffer stock?
We have tried road transport in tankers, because palm oil derivatives are liquid. So in tankers, we have also tried train transportation by transporting it through a rake of about 2,200 tons together. Both have worked if the transport provider is flexible enough regarding the rake timing, then the rakes work. But if they are very rigid that you have to run a rake every 3 days, then it doesn't work, because then you lose all the flexibility. So with flexible transportation, and in case of surface transportation, I mean road transportation, we do have flexibility. So we would tie up with 2-3 transporters who have such vessels, tanker vessels to take the material, and who are flexible enough to place either 50 tankers on a day or just 5 tankers, depending on how many do we need. So flexibility is important. We should tie up with somebody who insists that every day I will give you 10 tankers and nothing more, nothing less. So that type of inflexibility would hurt. So long as we keep it flexible, either rail or train, either rail or road, both would work.
Thank you very much, sir. The next question comes from Mr. Atish Goel. He says, in a non-FMCG environment, when the system is not flexible enough, in that case, what are the options available for?
Yeah. So firstly, we should make the system flexible. If it's not, there is no system which cannot be made flexible. And in case we are finding it extremely difficult to bring in flexibility, then we should work on the speed of response. So given the rigidness in the system, how can we respond faster? So given a particular level of flexibility, what's the best we can do in terms of response time is another leg. But much bigger benefits will come when we try to improve the flexibility, see really what's coming in the way. So there's no system in the world where we can't improve flexibility. No system is so flexible that it can't be improved. Every system can improve on its flexibility terms. So first recommendation would be to improve flexibility. And if response time is an issue, people are taking long to respond, then improve the response time in the meantime. Other option is to carry high inventory, but then you run the risk of both stockouts and excess inventory and obsolescence. So that's not recommended.
Right, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. The last question, this comes from Mr. Sparsh Saxena. He says, durables are much higher consumption, have much higher consumption period compared to FMCG goods. How to optimize inventory placement for both type of goods in a multi echelon supply chain?
Yeah. So durables, yes, you're right. If you take a particular consumer, then the repeat purchase cycle is very long. If I buy a fridge, I may buy the next one as a replacement after many years. So there are new consumption, new consumers who come into the durables market, plus there are repeat purchases. So both these have to be tracked. But if you take all the consumers put together, then the demand is not so lumpy. It does get averaged out, although the smoothness of demand is not as smooth as you find in FMCG. So there would be a bit of a lumpiness, which would mean that either you need a much better demand sensing tool, or you have to compensate with slightly higher inventory at the last leg from where you are supplying. And in, from the previous legs, you can go fully on replenishment. But the inventory buffer at the last node has to be slightly bigger. Then you can manage this inventory in the entire network very well. And keep improving, obviously, those two things of flexibility and responsiveness in the entire network. Where to place the buffer nodes is also important in case of durables, because the network from factory to the consumer may look quite different for durables compared to FMCG. We have seen many companies running a more compressed supply chain with less number of nodes in between, compared to FMCG, where typically you would have a node as a regional distribution center, then a CFA, and then a distributor and a retailer. In case of durables, many a times we see that CFAs would directly dispatch to the retailers. In some cases, people are willing to wait after placing an order, so then it can be dispatched directly to the consumer. So in many cases, the entire network can be compressed in case of durables, which is not so possible in case of FMCG, excepting in e-com cases where you can send direct delivery to the consumer. But in durables, it's a common practice that you go select your model, look at various options, select the model and say, okay, send the item directly to my home. It may take a couple of days, but you are okay to wait for a couple of days. So that way, it's a bit simpler because the consumer tolerance time is more and you can compress the network if the machine hasn't got obsolete.
Right. Thank you very much. I don't think we have much time left for more questions. So I will request Nistush now to give a vote of thanks.
Thank you so much for this wonderful session. So on behalf of Novoks Education, I would like to express my sincere gratitude to Dr. Rakesh Sinha for expressing his thoughts and for being with us this evening. It was really wonderful to listen all the wonderful examples and the way you have explained. You know, we have got a comments already in the section that it was very simply explained, very nicely done. It was wonderful listening from you, Dr. Sinha. And a very thank you to Mr. Ravindra Tulsiyan for hosting this first ever SCM talk show episode. So this is a series of episodes that we will run, as you said, every fortnight. Thanks to all the audience for taking out time on the weekend, you know, in the situation of COVID, when work from home has actually become more hectic than your office work and weekend has become much more important. Thank you for sparing 1 hour of your time and joining the session. We hope you learned a lot from the session and you liked it. Please do join us for the next episode of SCM Talk Show on 29th of August at 4 p.m. same time on the same link for the topic of digital supply chain management. Once again, thank you everyone for joining in, and here we are signing off. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.